Good afternoon to one and all. We hope everyone are doing great and being safe at home. We welcome you once again to the webinar series, Let's Connect. And today we have another interesting topic, which is brands in the time of Corona, the new normal. And let's get to hear from Professor Suresh Paul Antony. And before that, let me introduce the speaker to all of you. Professor Suresh Paul is with IIM Trichy from 2012. He is a fellow of the Indian Institute of Management, Lucknow, and an MBA from Madurai Kamaraj University. He underwent certification at Paris with StratX Simulations. He has also served in diverse industries for 14 years before making a career shift to academics. His core teaching interest lies in product and brand, taught earlier to both academic and executive participants at IIMs at Lucknow and Kozhikode. Excellare at Jamshedpur, Singapore and Dubai, besides the Asian Institute of Management at Manila. Professor Paul has undergone training in academic leadership in the UK. He has been actively involved in institution building at IIM Trichy and has made significant service contribution during its formative years. So without taking much of your time, I'm handing over the session to Professor Suresh Paul. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Pradeep, for the introduction. And I welcome all the co-learners to this short presentation on brands in the time of Corona, the new normal. So for the agenda, we shall take quick stock of the COVID saga, then review the role of brands in such times. We have faced disruption, but yes, are there opportunities available for brands and brand managers? And then we shall consider some essential steps for brand managers. What lessons can they draw from this experience? So this is the agenda for the day. The COVID saga so far, I think collectively we have attended far more than a fair share of webinars and discussions to fully know the impact of Corona. It looks like the world has stopped in its tracks. We were taken by surprise. We thought it will not hit us. Very soon it turned to anxiety and despair. As livelihoods were at stake, and very soon, health and safety became our paramount concerns. Our world has been disrupted like never before in living memory. We have a crisis on hand. It is not business as usual. If we were to execute a sentiment analysis, here are some keywords. Comprehensive it may not be. You can add to this list of sentiments. I've just tried to cover what are the sentiments running in the marketplace, in consumers' mind. So we have new language. We have changed attitudes. We have altered behaviors. We do not know which and how many of them are irreversible. So new normal, abnormal, difficult, trying, disturbing, a whole bunch of lingua which we have not been familiar enough before. So at the end of it, there is this urge to cocoon ourselves in safety, in the safety of our homes, work also in the safety of our homes. So cocooning has become a major trend at the end of the day that has fallen out of all of these sentiments. Now, in such difficult times, do brands have a role? Can they replace anxiety with confidence? Would consumers still want to be identified with their marketers, with their brands? Would consumers want to reduce their risks, monetary, social, and psychic? When favorite brands are not available, would they willingly incur search costs? Is the promise bond and pact still relevant to customers? Do symbols matter? Do brands signal quality and assurance and reliability? Having tasted private labels, since many of our favorite brands were not available on the shelves, would customers switch loyalties to local brands and private labels? Interestingly, many of the local brands that were never in our, even in our awareness set, have moved into our consideration set and our choice sets, and finally behavior, where we start liking some of those brands which we had never considered before. So that's an interesting factor of this scenario, that many of the local brands are getting into our choice sets. Now, how have brands behaved in such times? There are many examples. There are many anecdotal examples. There are many reports of how brands and brand managers have been functioning in these times. If you look at consumer education, right, you have many brands that have been educating customers on using masks, on using sanitizers, on distancing, on hygiene. A CEO of a large FMCG firm mentioned that what they were not able to do in terms of customer education regarding hygiene over the last 20, 30 years, they have been able to get it done quickly in the last 1 month or so. You had many of these brands, some of the names I could figure out, Ixigo, Tripoto, Netflix, Geo Cinema, Shamaru, T-Series, Amol, Dettol, TikTok, the Fevicol ads. So many of these brands have been active in this public service announcement messages. Banks have in turn offered moratorium for their borrowers. Ford Credit has offered credit support. Flexible ticketing by our own domestic airlines, IndiGo, SpiceJet, Ixigo, and also British Airways. Contactless has become the new fashion, the new trend. Contactless takeaway, contactless delivery, contactless installation. So you have Swiggy, Domino's, Pizza Hut, Dunzo, Urban Ladder promising contactless forms of delivery, takeaway, and installation. Some of the brands have diversified. For instance, Wildcraft and Budweiser have diversified into masks. Dabur and Asian Paints have diversified into sanitizers. A lot of freebies are being offered by brands. You have online courses by LinkedIn. You have Creative Cloud by Adobe. Some are offering more for the same, like Jio Internet is offering more talk time, is offering more data. There are some brands at the forefront of fighting misinformation, like you have Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, waging relentless battle against misinformation. You have Snapchat's Here For You tool that addresses anxiety, customer anxiety. You have health insurers extending coverage for COVID on existing policies. OYO Rooms has moved into the co-working space. You have local retailers, even at Trichy and elsewhere, who are offering local deliveries, which they never used to offer before. You have the WHO offering a chatbot to answer citizen anxieties. You had the Audi dealership in Delhi, which reimagined Audi's iconic logo to convey the message, keep a distance. You had an event management association in Kerala depicting Kathakali dancer to focus on the message of distancing. So a lot of activities, even though the budgets have been limited, budgets have been cut, companies are facing financial crunch, still they have managed, many of the brands have managed to be relevant and conveying messages to the consumers. Now, as the corona days get longer with the climate not so reassuring, we need to consider whether these brand actions and behaviors are just random acts. Are they serendipitous acts? Is there a method to this madness? Is there a playbook that consists of pieces and parts that make up your brand's go-to approach? Do we have a plan? Do we have an approach, a strategy, worked ahead of time? There's a saying, if you fail to plan, you plan to fail. So what are the essential components of a brand? Here are the four P's. Branding is a promise. Branding is the promise. The product is the vehicle. Promotion is a dialogue. And brand is the person. I shall elaborate on these four P's as we move on. Let me start with the first P. Branding is the promise. Now, brands need to stand for more than just making promises. My favorite example is to equate a promise to a covenant. Covenant, C-O-V-E-N-A-N-T. Though in this case, it's unwritten. A covenant is normally a pact between two parties which specifies what each can do and what each is not supposed to do. So, but in this case, in branding, a covenant is unwritten. There are many examples of covenants. If you look at the biblical times, where God made a promise to his chosen people that he will take them to a land where milk and honey flows, and in return they shall not worship any other god. So here a brand can be equated to a god, and their target consumers can be equated to the chosen people. In our own Indian mythology, we have Lord Krishna. He makes those six promises to Arjuna. So I'm emphasizing that here by promise, we mean a covenant which is more than just an ordinary promise. It's a divine promise, which is couched in infallibility, which is couched in a sense that it cannot be violated by any chance. But in history, if you look at branding history, there have been many fallen gods. There have been many fallen brands. The very famous example of Volkswagen, which was an iconic brand that broke its trust, built over several generations. So a promise, a branding and a promise, we need to remember that it's a kind of an agreement between the brand and its chosen people, the target consumers. So that's the first P, which is promise. But let's look at the reality. Here in the month of January 2020, just recent, the Advertising Standards Council of India, okay, it has many of these guidelines, several more guidelines. They have guidelines on advertising and food beverages, on usage of awards, rankings, disclaimers, skin lightening, fairness improvement products, and the use of celebrities in advertising. There are many more guidelines. You can go into the website of ASCI, Advertising Standards Council of India, to look at these guidelines. And in the month of January, can you imagine, they received complaints against 342 advertisements, 342 advertisements. The moment these marketers received notice, 110 of them withdrew promptly. And the balance 232 out of the 232 complaints left, okay, 208 complaints were upheld, which means that the marketers were asked to withdraw those advertisements. Now, why were they asked to be withdrawn? So here are some major reasons. Misleading and unsubstantiated claims, which fundamentally you're not making a promise that you can keep. Misleading and unsubstantiated claims. Disparaging current practices. Objectionable visuals that could cause harm and injury, especially to vulnerable populations like children. Extremely offensive and obscene language. So these are some of the major reasons, basis of which many of these advertisements were asked to be withdrawn. Now, which are the sectors involved? You have education, you have healthcare, you have personal care, you have real estate and foods and beverages. So my dear friends, I am emphasizing that brands, especially in such times, need to stay close to their knitting and do not make promises that they cannot keep. I think that's a very fundamental aspect of branding. Do not make promises that you cannot keep. Now let's come to the second P, which is the product. The product, in my view, is the vehicle. The product is the first P in the four Ps of the marketing mix. You have product, price, place, and promotion. Product is the first mix, first P. With place has a very strategic role to play. Now, brand managers have to constantly monitor the nature of consumer needs, which may constantly keep changing. Now, the question is, how do I meet those needs? I can meet those needs by deploying my own organizational resources and capabilities. The question is, to what purpose? At the end of the day, the organization seeks to maximize its return on assets, the return on assets that are deployed. And the product is the medium. Let's be very clear. The product is the medium to deliver the brand promise, which in turn ultimately aims for satisfaction of not only its chosen people, its target customers, but also the other corporate stakeholders. Okay, so that's the product. So without a product, okay, the brand doesn't make any sense. It's like growing a banana plant over a period of time. The outer shell is the product, and you'll have to wait for a long time, nurture the plant in such a fashion that over a period of time, you have the plant bearing fruit. If you notice a banana plant, it'll be in the center of the many layers, okay, of the leaves, right? So that's how a brand has to be nurtured, right? But without the product, there is no brand. Because many of us, or at least the layman view, is that, it doesn't matter whether the product is, viable or your promise is, truthful, but then just go ahead and advertise, and branding is equal to advertising. That's not the case, okay? Your product has to deliver the promise. So the product is the vehicle by which your promise is delivered. Now let's move to the third P, which is promotion. Promotion is about a few things. The first is to establish an identity. Is a brand considered or identified as a member of the category? For instance, is my drink considered when a customer feels thirsty? Or he wants to have a social gathering? Is my drink, is my brand, which is a drink, is it considered in such situations, in many of these usage situations? So that is the identity part. Do they know who I am? The second is, does it mean anything to them? Does it mean anything to my customers? Have we helped the customer bridge the gap between features, benefits, and values? Many a time we focus only on the features and customers don't care about the features. So are we helping the customers bridge the gap between features, benefits, and values? Do we know enough about our own customers? Do we have very vivid descriptors? I'll come back to that later. Have we highlighted our own heritage, the past experiences that customers have had with our brands? Responses. Have we considered the rational and emotional responses of consumers to a brand? And finally, relationships. Are we working towards engagement, building community, loyalty, and attachment? Are we connected with them? So it's very important that we listen to the voice of the customer. Are we listening? And if we are listening, we need to close the loop, work on the feedback, and let them know which of those feedback measures I am working, which I'm not working, and for what reason I cannot work on them. So a dialogue means a two-way communication. Any amount of communication will not be in excess in such times, where there is a lot of anxiety, where there's a lot of concern. So communication, even in a kind of an excess, will certainly work well. Now look at this concept of marketing experience orchestration. Have we identified, have the brands identified, tweaked and integrated all touch points that make up the brand? For example, you have airlines that talk of on-time arrival and departure. I'm not mentioning any names of brands. You can figure it out for yourself. Very proudly, they acclaim on-time arrival, on-time departure. When we refer to marketing experience, what we refer here is, are we considering the entry and the exit of the passenger? I'm just giving an example of an airline. Have we considered the entry and the exit of the passenger and the luggage? Okay, I hope I make sense. So it is not just about runway to runway. It is about the time I leave my home, I reach the airport, I check in my luggage, I reach the destination, and I pick up my luggage and get out of the airport. Okay, so that's the time that concerns the customer. So that experience from end to end makes up for the marketing experience, not just about on-time arrival and departure. So are we concerned about it? Have we understood the journey that the customer takes from, you know, the time he leaves his home to the time he reaches back to his home? So here is a statement by a CEO of, I think, Virgin, who says, to improve marketing experience, we look at the whole journey before guests get to the airport and when they leave at the other end. It may appear so commonsensical, but then look at this table. If you look at this table, here are 18 industries which have been ranked, which have been scored, and it is available in Hansa Securities Marketing Experience Report 2020. The state of marketing experience in India. So that's the source. The maximum score is 500. And the maximum that these 18, the highest that industry has been able to achieve is 233. Now look at many of these firms that have still not been able to manage their touch points seamlessly. So there is a lot of scope to ensure, okay? There's a lot of scope, there's a lot of potential for firms to kind of ensure that the marketing experience for their own customers is seamless. Now let's come to the person part. Now brand is the person. The product delivers the promise, but the brand lives in the thoughts, words, and deeds of its people. I am not referring to the brand as a metaphor concept, which we already know. Brand has a personality, no doubt. The user profile in turn sticks onto the brand. I'm not referring to that. I'm referring to the fact that additionally, every employee impacts brand experience, lending a great deal of variability. So it is not just one person's job, and there is a need to improve the morale of your own employees. It was David Packard of Hewlett-Packard, one of the co-founders of Hewlett-Packard, who said that marketing is too important to be left to the marketing department. So therefore, brands reside in the minds and hearts of not only its customers, but brought to life in the thoughts, words, and deeds of its employees and other stakeholders who have consumer-facing roles, which means your extended employees, all the boundary spanners that you have, including your outsourced employees, typically your dealer salesmen, okay, to the last line, right, the last mile. So each one of them has a major role to play in bringing the brand to life. So the brands live through the thoughts, words, and deeds of its people. And when I say people, I'm not just referring to the customers, to their employees, to all of those, including your outsourced employees who have customer-facing roles. So there are two heartwarming stories I wanted to share in recent times. One is the heartwarming story of Parle G, which is a 90-year-old brand with a massive 20% share of the 25,000 crore biscuit market in value terms. 20% of 25,000 crores. And it's considered to be the world's largest selling biscuit brand. Now look at its positioning. Some of the positioning statements that we have been able to figure out about this brand. It is ubiquitous, it is egalitarian, it's a comfort food, it's for the masses, it's class neutral, and it serves the bottom of the pyramid. There have been some interesting statements I could garner. A staple, it's considered like a staple, like atta and dal, and it's become a habit for many customers in India. It retails at just under 5 rupees for a 50 gram pouch. Now we know the lockdown took place. So just after the lockdown was announced, the first lockdown was announced by a prime minister, before they shut down the Bahadur Gar plant outside Delhi, the plant produced 25 tons of biscuits in less than 4 hours. And we know the story of many in the bottom of the pyramid, the migrants who survived just on this Parle G biscuits. So here is a statement of the manager who went back to the factory to ensure that he could manufacture as much as possible in the last 4 hours. So he says, we have to ensure the supply does not stop. It is a social responsibility. And nobody told him to do this. There was no external force that told him to do this. But then this is the kind of spirit, right? That the persons who make up the organization, right, who have promoted, who have ensured that the brand is made available to as many customers as possible. Here is another example I have, which is our own Maggie. We know in 2015, all was lost for the brand. And by 2019, it had surpassed pre-ban levels, both in terms of value and volume. Now, during lockdown days, we all know, we are also familiar, that many of us stockpiled this brand. And it has earned the nickname of a lockdown love and pantry staple for many consumers in this country, especially the bachelor kind. Now, here is a statement by Mr. Suresh Narayanan, CMD of Nestle. The mission of my team was inspired to rise to a national cause and provide an essential brand at that time. A national cause, no less. So that's the spirit, how brands are able to live in the persona of its own people. Now, what are the essential steps in order to do this? The 4 P's, the promise, the product, the promotion, and the person. The first step is to analyze your portfolio. This is actually very basic. These are basics which we should have done even in normal times. So the point I'm trying to make is it's time that we go back to school and look at our basics. The first step, the first basic step is to analyze your portfolio. Look at your mixed decisions. Look at your line. How long is it? How short it is? What about the number of lines are you carrying? What are the lines that you are carrying? How many SKUs do you have in your portfolio? Consider what is the nature of the market. What are your own resources? What is the philosophy of your firm? And then look at what should be the optimal mix. Now, how do I look at the optimal mix? There is no definition for it. There is no formula for it. But there are several situations that kind of tell you that your mix is not optional. For instance, you have chronically or seasonally recurring excess capacity in terms of production, storage, or transportation. Then it tells you that your mix is suboptimal. Or if you figure out that 20% of your portfolio is contributing to 80% of your value, 20% of your brands is contributing to 80% of the value, okay, then again it tells you that your mix is suboptimal. If there is a lot of slack in your sales force, that again suggests that your mix is suboptimal. Or if you find that your profits are declining or your sales is declining steadily, there again, it indicates to you that your mix is suboptimal. The other thing, the other step that you'll have to consider when you analyze your portfolio is to look at the mix, to look at the fit between your company and your brand portfolio. So here are some factors to consider. Consider your technological skills, your labor and management, your financial resources, your production resources and capacity, logistics, your sales force and channels, your target group, their needs. What is its impact on the line and mix? What is its impact on your image? What is the impact on the demand seasonality? So that's the fit. And once you do this, the next step would be to either abandon a brand, modify a brand, or introduce a new brand. Now, here we have the Mr. Sanjeev Mehta, chairman of HUL in recent times, in Corona times, who did mention that HUL is focusing only on essential SKUs. They're cutting down the flab in the mix. Several years ago, HUL, Hindustan Unilever, had done a similar exercise of looking at master brands, okay, where they reduced the number of SKUs in their portfolio. This is the best time to do that if you have not done this before, right? Brands need to do it constantly. If not done before, this is the best time to do. The first step is to analyze your portfolio. The second important step after this is to look at how do I strategize my brand? And here are the 8 essential steps. The first is to look at your competition. The second is to look at your customers. Describe those customers in as vivid terms as possible. Describe them in terms of their age, that's not enough, in terms of their social status, SEC, socioeconomic classification could be a good source of finding out what is their social status. Look at their lifestyles and attitudes. You have AIOs, attitudes, interests and opinions. AIO scales are available. Look at what is the usage and attitudes in this particular category, UNDA studies. So that's in terms of consumer profile. Look at what are the key insights, the key consumer insights. What is the need gap? Are there any unmet needs? That's the third important step. The fourth is to look at benefits. As I said before, you need to move beyond features. Move beyond features and look at benefits. What are those benefits? And those benefits are not just rational alone. They are also emotional. So kindly consider both your rational and emotional benefits. And the fourth, the fifth is values and personality. For instance, an Ayurvedic brand could have these values. Like for instance, it could be an expert, it could be effective, it could be progressive, it could be enduring, right? So these are the values, that normally a person would have, which a brand will also share, okay? The sixth is, what is the support? What is liquidity? What is the reason to exist? What is the essence? How will customers believe my promise? What is the reason to believe? That's the support part, okay? So the support will come from the ingredients, from your expertise. So that's the support. And the seventh would be the differentiator. How is your brand different from the other? What are the points of differentiation? Remember when I mentioned identity, I mentioned, have you been identified with the category? So that is point of parity. And here we are referring to, yes, I am considered point. I'm considered a member of the category, but am I different? So that's the point of parity, and here you have a point of differentiation. And finally, look at what your brand stands for, the promise, the core of it. For instance, it could be an authentic Ayurveda for lasting beauty, right? So this is the second important step. Once you analyze your portfolio, the second important step is to look at how can I strategize my brand. The third important step is to take a walk. So here, I am requesting that first, you remain on focus. Don't waste your resources, your time, effort, and money on unrelated segments. There is always a temptation, you know, to target your communication, especially in such times where it is very limited, on segments that are not part of your target group. So remain on focus. Don't waste your resources. Number two, marshal your resources, because there are cuts in marketing budgets all over. Look for alternatives. There are cheaper local methods of activating your brand promise. So look at them. Do we have alternative ways of doing it? And finally, look at feedback control, which means that you had a plan and we need to know where we end up and how are we going to rectify. So that's the third step, which is taking a walk. And the last step, the most important step, is to reflect. So here, reflect, number one, is to look at what you have done, because organizations have very short memory, and then you have high labor turnover, right? So it's very important that you document whatever has happened in such situations, right? Which will help us in, if at all, another situation were to come up later. And have a crisis management plan, which you should have had anyway. But this is a crisis that none of us would have ever imagined, right? but it's still worthwhile to have a crisis management plan with a very clear leadership, a single point of contact, a single person who is authorized to, you know, clear budgets and to take decisions. Have a very clear structure in place and have a very clear budget allocated for a crisis management, all right? So this is the fourth important step, reflect. So to recapitulate, the four components, the four important building blocks of your branding in such times is to look at the promise, look at the product, look at your promotion, and remember that your brands live in the thoughts, words, and deeds of the persons who represent the brand, whether it be your employee, whether it be your outsourced employee. And here are the four essential steps where you need to analyze your portfolio, strategize your brand, and act on your plan, right? Walk the talk. And finally, reflect, and it is iterative all over again. So this is where I end my presentation. I will open it up for questions.
Thank you, sir, for sharing your insights. It was really a wonderful session, and I hope everyone liked it. Now, I would like to open the floor for questions. Please feel free to write your questions on the Q&A section at the bottom of your screen. And sir, we could see already a bunch of questions that have been raised. And to the participants, due to paucity of time, we'll try to address as many questions as possible, and the rest shall be addressed offline. Shall we get into the first question, sir?
Right.
The question number one is, what do you predict COVID-19 pandemic will have an impact on cross-selling? Or how do you predict COVID-19 pandemic will have an impact on cross-selling?
Well, this is a very generic question. I doubt whether I'd be able to answer that, because cross-selling, again, it depends. Currently, customers are postponing their decisions regarding non-essentials. So if your cross-selling portfolio includes what customers consider as non-essentials, okay, you'll have a tough time. For instance, even biscuits, I'm told, was considered as a non-essential. So Parle had to, you know, really put in a lot of effort to ensure that it be considered as an essential. So that's from a government point of view. But here you're referring to customers who have their own views on what essentials are and what non-essentials are.
Moving to the second question, sir. What should small brands or startup should do systematically in order to take full advantage of this COVID situation and fight against the bigger players, market players?
Okay. Come again, what is the question?
What should small brands or startups should do systematically in order to take full advantage of this COVID and fight against major players in the market?
See, you'll have to relook at your own, the components of your brand, okay? I think I have given you a framework. That's a framework. So you look at your own promise. What is the promise? What does your brand stand for? Okay, even if it is a local brand, it's all right. So, but you have an opportunity. The local brands have had an opportunity like never before. They never had a share of the shelf. They never had a share of communication, but today, we got to know of brands which we had never heard of before. I'm sure each one of us have got personal examples that we have tried a brand which I never tried before, and I found it excellent. And now I'm looking around for that brand. I do not know where it is available. It was not normally available in the normal kind of, the large retail shelves. Okay. But, since many of my favorite brands were not available, you were forced to, kind of pick up something else that was available. And that's why I said many of those brands, the private labels, the local brands, which were never part of our awareness set, have become part of our awareness set. So now I think it's an opportunity for these small brands to look at these four P's. What is the promise? What is your product? Your product seems to be very good. So then what is your promise? Do you have a promise at all? And how are you having a dialogue? How are you having a conversation with your customers? Do you know who your customers are? And are the people who are associated with the brand, are they living the brand? Are they making a promise? So many a time, many of these local brands, is my understanding is that they start with a great product, right? They don't think of the other things, right? So therefore, I think they need to look at the other three P's as well. They might have a great product going for them, but then what about the other three P's?
So the next question is, the question goes like this. Is it okay to change positioning of brand due to this pandemic? Suppose if my brand is currently positioned for a particular segment, but the segment usage has come down, I find a new segment for usage. Will that be okay if I change the positioning, or will it affect in a long run?
Yeah, if you're going to change your positioning, you know, repositioning is near death. Whoever has asked me this question, let me make it very clear. Repositioning is near death, because first you'll have to erase, you'll have to undo those associations, those memories in the minds of those customers, and bring in a new kind of an association, okay, which is almost like starting afresh, right? So you'll have to do it very, very carefully and with a lot of caution. If you have nothing else to do, yes. So I think the question, I see it has been written, the segment usage is coming down, which means that segment is dying. So therefore, you don't have a choice. So you may want to look at new segments, right? Which means that you'll have to reposition. And when you reposition, please understand that you'll have to invest as much resource as you would have to do for a fresh positioning exercise, maybe even more.
Sir, the last question for the session would be, what is the weightage on the trade-off for the brand versus private labels?
Come again, please.
What is the weightage on the trade-off for the brand versus private labels? It is just at the bottom of the Q&A section, the very last question that came up, sir.
The trade-off?
For the brand versus private labels.
Last question.
Now, there are questions that keep coming in. By the time
so many questions. Yeah, got it. What is the weightage on the trade-off for the brand versus weightage from whose point of view? Is it the customer's point of view or from the marketer's point of view?
I guess they're asking from the customer point of view only, sir.
I mean, that's an individual choice. So today in this situation, when many of my favorite brands were not available, I had to pick on private labels. And I found some of them as good as, probably better than my favorite brands. And I'm hunting for some of them. I'm sure many of you have these examples. Brands that I've never tried before, right? I have tried today. Okay, and then that's the reality. We still have some time, no? Pradeep?
Yes, sir, we have. Would you like to take a couple of more questions, sir?
Yeah, sure, no problem. There are so many of them, I think. It's okay.
So, this is a question like, what's your advice to brand services company like advertising agencies?
Advertising agencies. Where is that question?
Maybe you'll have to scroll down till the end, sir.
Till the end. What is your view on changing consumer behavior? Is that the one now?
No. It's slightly on the top, which is from Ilankumaran G. What's your advice to brand services companies like advertising agencies?
Advertising agencies have to find new channels. They have to focus on content, user-generated content, and so on. So if you're looking at TV and the normal formal channels, I think they are facing challenges because budgets. There are many companies that are facing budget cuts. So it's not going to be easy, okay, to get back the normal way of advertising. So you'll have to look at other ways. For instance, there was this company which was trying to build awareness in many of the housing societies in Coimbatore recently, right? And they were asking me, what do we need to do? So obviously, they don't have budgets even if they had budgets, you do not have the facility to shoot a commercial, right? So then what do you do? So you'll have to look at how can I have some local activations. So we figured out maybe they have a van where they could, enact a kind of a skit, right? And take it to different corners of the city because no one is going to let you in, right? So it has to be seen from far, right? So you need to think in terms of these creative methods that how do I reach my customers if I don't have my budgets to do it through the television and so on. So recently I also read about how outdoor, out-of-home media may soon turn digital. So like right now we are going and painting those hoardings and so on. That may not be possible after some time. So therefore, you will have a digital board. So there are a lot of new things that are going to happen. And you need to look at how do I reach my end customers. So that's my kind of an answer.
And would you like to pick another couple of questions from the Q&A section, sir?
Yeah, you go ahead. You decide. Okay. You're the boss.
Is this the right time to launch e-commerce, especially on healthcare products?
Yeah, e-commerce has a great opportunity. If you see even that market orchestration experience, market experience orchestration table that I shared with you, e-commerce is at the top of the pecking order. Okay, this is a great opportunity as long as you are able to ensure that it is orchestrated well, right? The weakest point is normally the delivery and returns. Okay, if customers are going to return the as long as you're able to manage that, things should be fine. Yes, sir.
Another question, the last question for today's session is, okay, is starting off a small scale venture in fashion at this situation safe, or is it better to wait to get things normalized?
Oh, this is like a consulting question.
Yeah.
Should we get into fashion? Yeah, fashion. Why not fashion? Today you have masks that are, they don't look like masks, right? So if you can have masks like that, I think fashion will get back into fashion. So why not have a look at it? As long as you are able to, let me reiterate, do you have a very clear promise in place? You may have a great product, but do you have a promise? Do you know who your customers are, right? If I go back to that slide where I was referring to strategize, I hope you remember that slide. Where was the one? Yeah, here. If you look at this, what is important to all of my friends, I would reiterate, have you asked all of these questions? If you have not asked, then you have a problem. You will not be able to work on your brand. All right.
Yes, sir. So we can move to the last slide, sir. And thank you so much for clearing the doubts. And thanks to everyone who had joined the session. And thanks for being a wonderful audience. So we just wanted to inform you that there is another webinar which is scheduled for tomorrow, that is on 17 June. And details of that webinar is posted on the chat. You can look at it. There is a registration link. I would request all of you to join that webinar. And with this, I think we are done with this session, and probably we'll wait for a couple of minutes for you to make a note of this upcoming session, and then we'll wind up the webinar.
Yeah, there are a lot of questions here. I would suggest to the attendees that you're welcome to write to me. My email ID is spa@iimtrichy.ac.in.
SPA. We'll capture the questions and share with you, sir.
Pardon?
We'll capture the questions. Whatever that is here, we'll capture those questions and we'll share with you.
But how will I contact them?
Okay. Yeah, we will give you the details. You can answer those questions. We'll send it to them.
Okay. That's a good idea. But otherwise, I'm saying this is my email ID, spa@iimtrichy.ac.in. Thank you so much for being a very nice audience. And thank you, Pradeep. And thank you, team from Pearson, for organizing this. Thank you so much. Have a great day.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Have a great day.
Thank you.